Okay, good morning. We will continue our lecture. Any doubt in the previous lectures? We have started the sequential part, right? Combinational parts we already completed, some arithmetic of operation, the multiplication, right? Then some basics, our counter, shift register, multiplexer, all those things we will see as we progress subsequently, because those are all the part of our discussions, right? So now we enter into the sequential circuits. I told you sequential circuit also basically the combinational circuits. The way how we are going to wire the components will make it the sequential circuit, right? But there is no any special circuit or dedicated circuit called sequential circuit. Nothing is there. Again, that is also will be consist of AND gate, OR gate, NOT gate, NAND gate, some basic combinational components only. But if we are going to wire such a way that that fellow can stay at a particular state, right? Even though we change the input, the output will not be changed, because that is the way that is wired or that is configured among the components. So that we'll see subsequently. Before going into that part, one should understand what is the digital clock manager. Digital clock manager. This is a very important unit, very important section in any design, any sequential design particularly, because as I told you, on onboard clock, there will be a one or two crystals, right? In the FPGA, you take any development board, there will be one or two crystals. One may be typically at 50 megahertz, another one may be at 100 megahertz, right? Typically. Or some other clock inputs also will be there, but these are all for the RF frequency. For example, this is for FPGA, one clock is at 100 megahertz, maybe one more onboard clock here, maybe the one more another crystal, this may be 50 megahertz, right? And there will be some SMA connector, RF port, RF connectors will be there. These are all for high frequency clock, maybe 4 gigahertz, 5 gigahertz. But this frequency will not directly go into our digital circuit. That will go to the internal hardcore IPs for some internal operations. Right? For example, maybe IQ generation or the high speed sampling, or there may be some high speed ADC on the board. So this clock will go to that ADC. Right? In the same way, you can bring out some clock also here. This may be RF input clock. These are all the input clock. This may be the RF output clock. So these things will go directly deal with the RF section, not for our digital design, right? So digital design is the application, logic, algorithm, right? So those things will sit in the digital. There will be some specific IPs also, IP, hardcore IP, softcore IP. For activating those IPs, we need to pump the RF signal externally, or we need to bring out the RF signal to the external circuits from the board. So those port will be for that dedicated applications, right? So now we will understand what is this guy. What is the digital clock manager? How are you going to manage them? How are you going to generate the different clock out of them, right? So first we will see the decimation. That means down conversion, clock down conversion. Clock down conversion. Clock down conversion. Then subsequently, we will see clock up conversion. Clock up conversion, right? Clock down conversion in the sense, we are going to reduce the clock now. Reduce the clock by some factor. By some factor. That means here, division is required. Yeah, division is required. So whenever you divide your clock by certain factor, you will generate the new clock, right? Or whenever you are dividing one clock by several factors, you will generate the several subclocks, right? In up conversion, we are going to increase the clock. Increase the clock, right? Increase the clock by certain factor, some factor. Here we needed to do multiplication. Here we needed to do multiplication, right? Suppose if here you have 50 megahertz onboard clock, if you divide it by 2, it will be result into 25 megahertz. It will be result into 25 megahertz. If you have your onboard clock is 50 megahertz, if you multiply it by 2, you will have 100 megahertz. You will have 100 megahertz. So here we reduced the clock here we increased the clock, right? So this one should to manage the clock, because there will be a lot of resources, million into million resources are available inside the board. You needed to drive the VGA, you need to drive the HDMI, you need to drive some RF port, drive the fiber connector, right, fiber optical cable. You needed to drive several hardcore IPs, several IP core IPs, right, subcore IPs. So one should need to generate several clocks out of one clock, right, based on one clock. So the logic is generating clock, generating multiple clocks, maybe by multiplying or maybe by dividing, right, should not be out of the phase to the master clock. Everything should be controlled by the master clock. Nothing should run on its own. If it is running on its own, then all the operations will be out of the control of the master. It is something like this. Suppose this is one master unit. This is one master unit. Typically, we call it as a finite state machine or a finite state engine. We will see how to design these things subsequently. Master unit, right? Finite state machine or finite engine. So the master clock will directly go to this unit only. This is the master clock. In the master unit, there is one section is called DCM. One section is called DCM, Digital Clock Manager. We are only going to make all those things in the FPGA. Nothing is available already, right? So this is our DCM, Digital Clock Manager. The master unit FSM is there. So this fellow will control so many sub operations. So many will be there. Right? And there will be some other parallel pipeline stages also will be there. So this will go there, this will go there, this will come, this will be there. Then finally, it will go to some other section. Right? Then the output will come out here. Maybe this also may be the output, this also may be the output, or this all things may be the output now. So all those things are inside the FPGA. Inside the FPGA, right? That means there will be some inputs. Maybe one input will come here, or one input will directly go here, because this will manipulate something, these inputs, then it will distribute it to this unit. So there are several stages now. So stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4, then finally maybe our Y1, Y2, Y3. So dear students, in this kind of design, there will be so many modules, there will be so many architectures. All the architecture should be properly handled by the master, right? That means when the addition should happen, when the shifting should happen, how many times that shifting should happen, right? When the multiplication should happen, when the FIR filter should be applied, or when the video processing algorithm should be enabled, when it should be stopped, when the output should be latched out, right? And when the input should be read out, when the input should be brought inside the FPGA. So there will be a huge management. The huge management means a data handling is very, very huge inside the FPGA because of its capability. Lot of resources are there now, right? So this handling and this control also huge in number. Also, it should happen at a very high speed, ultra speed may, right? So ultra speed in the sense we talk about nowadays, gigahertz speed now. So all those things will happen at the gigahertz speed. So the quantity of processing also is very high, and the processing speed also is very high. So everything should be in the proper synchronization. Even if there is any out of phase by 1 nanosecond delay or 1 microsecond delay, then everything will be in confusion. Then you will not get your expected output. You will get some malfunction, or you will get some unexpected wrong output now. So everything should be handled here properly. So the master clock is the phase control for everything. Phase control for everything in the sense, whatever the sub clock we are generating here, everything with respect to this clock only. Everything with respect to this clock only. Because master is going to work with respect to this clock only. So with respect to phase of this clock, with respect to rising edge of this clock, with respect to falling edge of this clock, or level of this clock, logic 1, logic 0 level of this clock, all other actions will be controlled by the FSM now, right? If you stop this clock, no action will taken inside. No action will be taken place inside, because everything depends on the master clock only. In fact, it is required also now. Until unless if you leave them to work on their own, then this will work in some time. At that time, this fellow may not supply the input to this circuit, right? And this fellow may require the circuit in some other way, and this circuit will supply the input in some other way, right? So nothing will be in synchronization. Therefore, in sequential circuits, the time management is very, very important. Time management in the sense here, clock management. Time management is very important. Time management is very important. Time in the sense here, clock. Completely clock. But a clock is a real-time clock. Therefore, it is a time management, real-time management now. Right. So, as we continue, I have here one onboard clock. Onboard clock is there. Its frequency is maybe 4 megahertz. Onboard clock frequency is 4 megahertz now, right? Now my intention is I want to generate 1 hertz out of it. 1 hertz, right? 1 hertz, 10 hertz, 100 hertz, right? 1 megahertz, 2 megahertz, 3 megahertz, so whatever it is. So I want to convert this frequency into 1 hertz. Maybe I have some controller there, relay-like control. So relay can be operated at low frequency only. You cannot pump high frequency signal into the relay, any kind of like a buzzer, relay, right? These are all the electrical devices. So we needed to pump at the very low frequency. In fact, your 7-segment display also, or multi-segment display also, because if you send a high-speed display data to the 7-segment display, it will display everything. You cannot make out what is there in the display, right? If you send at a high speed, all the LED will glow. It appears that all the LEDs are on. So you cannot make out what is the number is there at the particular instant of time. So 4 megahertz to 1 megahertz now. So it is something like that. So this is our FPGA. We are going to make one DCM inside. This is 4 megahertz. I need to get 1 hertz now. Right? That is a divider. 1 hertz now. Now, to make the circuits in this DCM, right? Because DCM is not the ready-made block there. For Afghan, there are ready-made clocks. Remain ready-made manager also available in the advanced FPGA. So that also you can manage, but you should know how to feed the parameters into it. How to feed the parameter means, again, it will ask you some certain parameters that you should understand the fundamentals to give the parameters to the DCM to increase the clock or decrease the clock now. To feed the data, you should be strong in the basic idea. What are they first of all? They will ask you what is the decimation factor, what is the input frequency, what is the output frequency, what should be the duty cycle, right? And what kind of clock you want to generate? 90% duty cycle, 10% duty cycle, 50% duty cycle. Rising edge should be what? Falling edge should be what? So this will ask you certain parameters in the IP cores, right? So that we will see the IP core and all in the second unit. So now look here. The 4 megahertz is going and 1 megahertz is the required clock now. So we will understand first, what is the 4 megahertz? The 4 megahertz is something like this. Maybe if you take 1 second, right, once again, this is amplitude. We know very well in the digital there are only two levels, 1 and 0. So 1, 0, again 1, 0, right? So this is 1 cycle, this is 2nd cycle, right? This is 1, this is 2. That means 1 cycle starts or 1 cycle ends here, and 2nd cycle starts or 2nd cycle ends here. Then this is the 3rd cycle begins here. So like this, at this point, it will be 4 into 10 power 6. 4 into 10 power 6 clocks are there within a second, right? Within 1 second, the Chota crystal oscillator is capable of pumping 4 into 10 power 6 clocks per second. Clocks per second, right? You write a number. What is 4 into 10 power 6 means? How many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You tell me in number. 40 clocks per second. Kitna lakhs?
40 lakhs.
40 lakhs pulses per second. Can you able to imagine? 40 lakhs pulses. The crystal oscillator is a very small oscillator, this much only. This much only. So that oscillator is capable of pumping 40 lakhs pulses within a second now. Right? Within a second now. High speed clock. This is just 44 megahertz. 40 lakhs pulses. 9 gigahertz ke liye, you imagine. 12 gigahertz clock, you imagine. 8 gigahertz clock, you imagine. So if you pump here at 4 megahertz here, then this DCM, no, the circuit is capable of reading the pulse at that speed and doing some operations at the same speed and giving you the output now. So if you do one function, if you execute one instruction per clock, you can able to execute 40 lakhs instructions within a second. If it is in the FPGA, right? No embedded system will support for this much high speed computations or high speed processing. So 200 megahertz is there, 500 megahertz is there, 1 gigahertz is there now. Imagine the computation is at the ultra speed now. Computation is at a very high speed now. You no need to wait for anything. Understand? So straight away at the moment when you apply your input, output is available there because everything is over. So you can apply any number of filter, any order of the filter, image processing algorithm, signal processing algorithm, satellite imaging, video imaging, voice, sound, radar setup, sonar data, any kind of processing can be taken place in the FPGA because of its ultra speed computation capability. Ultra speed computation capability. Understand? Now, you look there, therefore 40 lakhs of pulses are coming out. Right. 40 lakhs of pulses are coming out now. 40 lakhs pulses. Right. See the rising edge then. The rising edge should be in the order of a few nanoseconds then. Because it is a 40 lakhs pulses are coming out, 4 megahertz pulses are coming out. So we can compute the time. What is the time for one pulse? If it is a 40 megahertz, 1 divided by 4 into 10 power 6 is equal to how much? What is the time for one pulse now?
250 nanosecond.
Just imagine one pulse time is a 250 nanosecond now. So one pulse duration is 250 nanosecond. Then you imagine the rising edge. Rising edge will be very, very, very less now. 1 nanosecond, 0.1 nanosecond. Because within 0.1 nanosecond, that pulse should reach its maximum. So ultra speed. So this DCM or this device is capable of sensing the pulses which is arriving it at the rate of 250 nanosecond. That means subsequently, so every 250 nanosecond there will be one pulse, one rising edge, one falling edge. Then second 250 nanosecond, one more rising edge, one more falling edge now. Understand? So this time is half of this time is a 175 nanosecond, right? 175 nanosecond. You see, so very short, this very short period, here also very short period. Within the short period, you are getting the pulses here now. You imagine ultra speed it is coming up. Very high speed it is coming inside the FPGA now. So that fellow is reading it now. So the idea is here, so within a second, this is 1 second. This 1 second, 1 second may we are getting 40 lakhs pulses, 40 lakhs pulses or cycles. Now our intention is we want to reduce this one into this clock into something like this, right? I want to generate something like this. Correct now? What is the frequency of this part? Again, this is a time. This is amplitude. Right. What is the clock of this? Is 1 second again. 1 second. What is the frequency of this pulse? This is 1 second. 1 hertz. This is nothing but 1 hertz. Simple. This is nothing but 1 hertz now. Because within a second, we have only one cycle. Within a second, we have only one cycle now. So this frequency is 1 hertz. Here 50% on, here 50% off, but here also 50% on and 50% off. So duty cycle is remain same. Duty cycle is remain same, right? So 50% on, 50% off. But my intention is I want to generate here. I want to generate here one low frequency signal. That means 1 hertz signal, 1 hertz signal out of 50 megahertz. I mean out of 4 megahertz in this example now, right? So how do we generate? What is the logic involving in it? What is the general logic, right? What is the general logic to generate such a clock? So now I am in need of 1 hertz. I may be in need of 10 hertz later, right? Maybe in another application. Again, this is 1 second, right? 1 second. Again, try. Suppose I am taking like this. Now, what is the frequency?
2 hertz.
2 hertz.
Here, f equal to 2 hertz. Simple. F equal 2 hertz. Here, f equal to 1 hertz now, right? So, see, what is the duty cycle again? Again, 50% duty cycle only. Here also, 50% duty cycle only, right? So, still duty cycle is remain same, but we generated the 2 hertz now. 2 hertz. Here, 2 hertz. Here, 1 hertz out of our 50 hertz. In the same way, we may be in need of some 1 kilohertz or 1 megahertz or 100 kilohertz, right? Or 3 megahertz in the down conversion, in the decimation, right? In the reducing the clock side. So how do I generate it? What is the architecture required? What I needed to do to get such a clocks? That we will see now. So what we needed to do, there is one architecture now, right? That architecture is, this is our counter. I'm going to make one counter now. Counter. This is our onboard clock. Onboard clock. The onboard clock rate goes into the counter. Followed by the counter, there will be one comparator. There will be one comparator. Right, this is the reference value, then the comparator output goes into one NOT gate, go to one NOT gate, something like this, level triggered NOT gate, something you like, take like this, this is the output, this is the NOT gate. Not gate, right? This we will see in depth this one in the lab, how this can be made. Not gate. This is the final output. Final output. This is the M underscore clock. Master clock. Maybe we are now taking it as 4 megahertz. Now these are all inside the FPGA. This is inside the FPGA. This is nothing but one digital clock manager. I'm going to get the 1 hertz here by giving the 4 megahertz. I'm going to get 1 hertz here now, right? You will understand. This is a counter. This is the binary comparator. Binary comparator. This is again the binary counter. Binary counter, right? This is the reference value. Binary counter. Fine. Then this one is called the feedback I am taking now. This is called reset. This is called reset. Right. This is an excellent logic. You will come to know many things. Right. I am moving further to take you to the closer to the design. So you look now, you will understand what is this guy, how the modules are distributed and how this works. Then you will see how this value can be found. So we are pumping the clock here. We are pumping the clock inside to this counter. So this binary counter keep counting it. So we are going to make the binary counter such a way that if rising edge comes or if the falling edge comes, you increment its value now, right? So I made a sudden counter. Maybe we can write like this. Suppose your CNT is equal to CNT plus 1. C and D is equal to C and D plus 1. But when C and D equal to C and D plus 1, if rising edge comes, or falling edge comes, that depends, that is left to us, right? So if rising edge comes there, then you increment count equal to count plus 1. Already count is initialized to 0. Therefore, the count will start from the 0. Right. So every count will have for the every rising edge or every falling edge now. Because that is the way the counter is designed here. Right. So if rising edge of M clock, then count equal to count plus 1. Therefore, whenever this rising edge comes here, this counter will work. So now you understand this counter is capable of incrementing its value for every rising edge, in the sense this counter is working at the rate of 250 nanosecond, right? So this counter should be capable to sense that edge and increment its value within 250 nanosecond, because after 250 nanosecond immediately another one rising edge will come. You understand now? So just imagine if this counter is a 100 bit counter, or if the counter is a 50 bit counter, the 50 bit counter means how many register is required for 50 bit counting. If you are an MSI technology, you needed to keep, you need cast 100 D flip flops for 100 bit counting. Understand? So to count the 4 bits, you should have 4 flip flops, because this flip flop output will be D0, D1, D2, D3, 0000, 1000, 1100. Correct? No? So you need 4 flip-flops for 4-bit counting. So 100 flip-flops are required for 100-bit counting. So now we are telling this counter is capable of counting for 100 bits. So D0 to D99 can be counted. So you can count from 0 to 250. You can count from 0 to 40 lakhs. You can count, you can make a counter to count from 0 to 1 into 10 power 9. 50 lakhs counter is possible. So 1 crore counter is possible. You imagine there is a counter which can count its value from 0 to 40 lakhs, means how many registers are required. But all the registers updation happened within 250 nanosecond. You understand now? It should happen, in fact, well, very, very quickly than the 250 nanosecond. Because the reading time is there, then the incrementing the counter time is there, the processing time is there, propagation time is there, and then making the entire circuit to settle at one stable state is there. So all these things should happen before the occurrence of the subsequently another rising edge. You got the idea now? So therefore, the computation, the increment, everything should happen within 250 nanosecond. If it extends to some other time other than 250 nanosecond plus a delta time, then the counter will miss subsequently one clock. Then alternatively it will miss all the clocks then. So once if you miss one clock, understand, then your clock, input clock will go down by 2. Understand now? So 250, 4 megahertz clear, we are telling 250 nanosecond. 500 megahertz imagine. So that much ultra speed computation is mandatory here now. But already technology is there. That is why I'm telling you, the VLSI engineer, embedded engineers are the mostly wanted engineers to the society. Because everything is in here only. I'm telling you, in future there will be a photonic IC. Then next generation will be the quantum IC. No electrons. Electrons will be gone soon. Light will go in the IC. Already ICs are there. Do you know idea which is the first IC where the photon glows inside the chip? You all should know. What is that? Any idea? One IC is there that always we use it for coupling or isolation. Optical coupler, optocoupler IC. Optocoupler IC is the IC already where you are. LED is there and photodiode is there. A photodiode or phototransistor is there. Already light is going. Inside it is traveling. That we use for coupling purpose. Electrical to electrical coupling in order to avoid the back EMF. In order to avoid the back, just you Google it, you will get it. Optical coupler, optocoupler IC. Okay, fine. So this counter is now capable to count from 0 to 40 lakhs, 0 to 50 lakhs now. So what I am doing, I am giving the master clock inside to this counter. This counter is keep incrementing its value. At the same time, this counter sends its current value to this comparator. Current value to this comparator now. In this comparator, already I have written one number here, that is the reference number. I have written here 220 lakhs here. 20 lakhs I stored here now. Already I stored the 20 lakhs now. You imagine to store a 20 lakhs is a big number. Correct, no? So I can store the 20 lakhs in the FPGA nowadays. Because 20 lakhs storing, you need a huge number of binary bits. Because 20 lakhs is the integer number or the decimal number cannot be stored as it is. Right? It should be converted to binary. So you should have sufficient registers there. Understand? So 20 lakh can be stored there. So 20 lakhs is given here now. 20 lakhs is given here. So what this comparator does, this comparator reads this value and compare with the reference value all the time. All the time. Its job is it is comparing. It is comparing now. So it is comparing all the time. So at the moment, whenever this value and this value is equal, whenever this value and this value is equal, then this comparator will give one trigger out here. Will give one trigger out here. Will give one trigger out in the sense, see, this is the comparator we have written. If rising edge is there, count equal to count plus 1. That's all. Count equal to count plus 1. Then this value is already, it is taken into this process now. What this process is there, this process is doing, if count is equal to reference, if count is equal to reference, understand then you generate one trigger. You generate one trigger in the sense, it goes here. That trigger means here, suppose I am writing, for example, y temp is equal to not of y temp. Y temp is equal to not of y temp now. If initially if y temp is zero, y temp is zero, when this trigger pulse comes here, then what this fellow will do, already y temp is zero, now the y temp will become one. Now the y temp will become 1. It is something like that. X equal to not of x. X equal not of x because x can be the in out, no? So we can make in out. So x is the in out, therefore x can be input also as well as the output also now. So x is the input. So x equal to not of x. So y temp is equal to not of y temp. Therefore, what happens now? This y temp equal not of y temp. Initially, I loaded the 0 to y temp. Right. So therefore, now at this instant, this becomes 0 becomes 1 or 1 becomes 0. 1 becomes 0. Initially, if I loaded 1 here, to y temp, right? Now, if I take the not here, then it will become 0. It will become 0 now. It will become. So, what is then at the same instant that the value is coming back to this counter? Therefore, we have written additionally, if the trigger is on, then you refresh your counter. Refresh your count value now. Refresh your count value in the sense, once the trigger comes to the binary counter, then the binary counter C and D is equal to now becomes 0. C and D now it becomes 0 now, right? So the idea is master clock is coming, we keep counting the counter, and we are also comparing the count value with one reference value, right? Reference value. If these two are equal, then I am making the complement of the output. Also, I am refreshing my counter. Again, my counter keep counting. Again, the counter keep counting, then it will definitely reach that same value, right? Same value. Then again, it will reference now, so that 1 becomes 0, 0 becomes 1 now. So now you come to this part. So now what happened? Initially, I loaded the y temp. The y temp is coming out here. So y temp is equal to y out. Y out is equal to y temp. So whatever is happening inside will be coming out. Will be coming out now. So what I am doing, this I am taking, this is the y temp now. Y term, right? So initially I loaded the y term. You should understand one thing, everything is happening in the real time. Everything is happening in the real time means there is a subsequent clock is coming. The clock is real time clock, 250 nanoseconds, then another 500 nanoseconds, 750 nanoseconds, 1000 nanoseconds. So it is a real time clock now. So it is going on. So initially I loaded the y term equal to 1. Therefore, it is at this instant, at the beginning, at this instant. Then after 250 nanoseconds, 250 nanosecond, the y temp will be in the 1 only. Y temp will be 1. Right? Because the trigger was not generated till now. Right? The counter goes to 1. Now after 500 nanosecond, the counter goes to 0. The comparator compares the 20 lakhs with 2, not equal. Then 1 lakh and 50,000 clocks, the count value. At one instant, it will match 20 lakhs, no? So that instant, this fellow will be triggering, counter will reset, then the complement will take, and so this fellow will come down here. Will come down here. That means every every 20 lakh clock, every 20 lakh clock, 22 into 10 power 6 clocks, there is a complement. There is a complement now, right? So 2 into 10 power 6 clocks, there is a complement. Then again the counter is initialized to 0 here, right? Then again the again to 20 lakhs clock count, again count clock, again one complement, again one complement, then counter goes to 0, again another 20 lakhs, again one complement, counter goes to 0, again 20 lakhs, counter will be 0. So this clock keep on coming. As long as your master clock is going into FPGA, your 1 hertz clock also will be available. 1 hertz clock also will be available now, right? This is the basic idea to generate the subclock from the master clock now. Suppose now you tell me, how do you calculate this time now? How do you calculate this reference value now? How can you compute this reference value? Suppose I am telling you, I want to generate a 4 hertz clock. What will you do? I want to generate the 4 hertz clock now. So 4 hertz clock means, what should I do now? I have to obviously reduce this 20 lakhs. You should reduce the 20 lakhs, right? So instead of 2 complements, there should be a 4 complement now. I mean 8 complement now actually. Right. So what should be the reference value now for 4 hertz? Tell me, what is the value for 4 hertz? For every
2.5
lakhs. 10 lakhs.
How 10 lakhs?
2.5
lakhs, you calculate karo to every 2.5 lakhs mein, are you getting a 4 clocks?
0.5 megahertz.
5 lakhs.
Check karo 5 lakhs, kaisa 5 lakhs chalega? You check karo.
50,000, sir.
You check then, for all your value, you check now. Every 50 lakhs, you take all complement, draw there, then whether that is equal to 40 lakhs.
No, no, sir.
So 4.
50,000, sir.
You check. You are telling different values now. So this is 1 cycle, 2 cycle, 3 cycle, right, and 4 cycle. So 1 pulse, 2nd pulse, 3rd pulse, and 4th pulse. Ho jayega. So there should be a complement. Initially loaded 1 now. So if the complement happens at 1 lakh, what happened? So 1 lakh complement, 2 lakhs, 3 lakhs, 4 lakhs, nahi hoga. 1 lakh me. You all of you check and give me the correct value. You check, you take the complement for all your count value. Because 8 times there should be a complement, no?
5 lakhs.
5 lakhs chalega? Check karo 5 lakh liyo. You understand,
yes,
this logic now. If you take here 5 lakhs, right, 10 lakhs, 15 lakhs, right, 20 lakhs, 25 lakhs, 30 lakhs,
so 35 lakhs.
Lakhs, huh?
5 lakhs.
Correct. 5 lakhs is the correct answer. How did you find this value? We will generalize this equation now, right? We need to generalize this equation now. So how can you generalize this equation now? Your onboard clock, your master clock, the reference value is equal to, reference value is equal to your onboard clock, right? Onboard clock by 2. Onboard clock. Suppose we will understand one logic now, right? 4 megahertz is there. 4 megahertz is our clock. 4 megahertz by the record clock is here, 4 hertz now. Record clock is 4 hertz now. If you divide by the record clock, what will be there? 1 × 10^6. 1 × 10^6 now. What is 1 × 10^6 now? When you divide the master clock by the record clock, we are getting one number now. That number is the time, right? Or the how many? That is the number of the clock that is required for one full cycle. But to generate that cycle, we need to take 2 times complement. To generate one cycle, we need to take 2 times complement. 1 1 1 0 and 1 1. Correct, no? Or 1 1 1 0. Therefore, again by 2. So onboard clock divided by record clock whole divided by 2. So that is equal to now. Onboard clock divided by 2 times of record clock. Two times of the record clock is the generalized equation to get the reference value. So the reference value, one should append the reference value before starting the design. That reference value is equal to onboard clock divided by 2 times of record clock. Why the 2 is here? Because of a 2 times complement. 2 times complement for every clock. This will give you the 50% duty cycle clock. 50 cycle duty cycle clock, right? But now, since it is a 4 megahertz, we got 50,000. We got the 5 lakhs for 4 megahertz. If it is 8 megahertz, the value is different now, right? So your onboard clock is different. This value is not constant for all the master clock to generate 1 hertz or 10 hertz or 4 hertz now. So one should compute the reference value based on the onboard clock value. What is the value of the onboard clock? Based on that, we need to calculate it now, right? So now I will ask you one question. The onboard clock is a 10 megahertz. Sorry, 10, maybe 500 megahertz. 500 megahertz. Tell me the reference value for. Just 1 minute. Tell me the reference value for. Maybe 1 hertz, 10 hertz, 200 kilohertz. 200 kilohertz and 3 megahertz. You tell me the reference value for these things. You calculate and tell me now. That means now there will be a counter. You tell me the reference value for these things and then we will continue for further discussions on this topic. 1 hertz ke liye, what should be the counter value?
250
megapulse. You tell me now number, count me. 250 × 10^6. Bus. No hertz here because this is a count value. No frequency here. One number, integer number, 250 × 10^6. For 10.
25 × 10^6.
200 kilohertz.
1000.
1000? Only 1000?
Yes.
3 megahertz?
166.6.
166 point.
Sir, it is 83.3.
Sir, and 200 kilohertz. 500. 500 and it is 83.3.
Okay, we take it as 83 now because 0.3 is not right now. We do not consider. We will consider later. 83. We will take 83. 83 only 83 or what? Only 83.
Yes.
Okay, fine.
Now, so for 200 kilohertz, it is coming 1.25 k, sir.
Yes, sir.
You check then others, no? Others carefully calculated.
Others
not be any error. Okay, right. So one head say you apply this equation and found it. No, any complicated things here. So 1 hertz ke liye 250 in 10 power 6 is the reference value. 10 hertz ke liye 25 in 10 power 6, 200 kilohertz can be generated by giving the reference value 1.25 into 10 power 3, then 3 megahertz 83. Now, like this, we need to generate so many subclocks. Now the idea is, how are we going to generate it now? So one is that this is the way that we discussed till now. This is one way to do it. It means a here one counter, here one counter, right? Then one more counter here, then another counter, and there will be another separate comparator, right? This is another separate comparator. So here also one comparator, or inverter here, right? So this is another way of doing it. Parallelly, you can design. So, but the onboard clock is same to everybody. This is only our 500 megahertz. 500 megahertz is the input into this counter, right? And also this counter, then your comparator. So this output is coming out. So whatever we have seen, whatever we have discussed there is working parallelly here. That is the way how we calculated these numbers. Maybe this one Y1, Y2, Y3, and Y4.